Well, there have been extraordinary scenes in Berlin tonight as thousands of people gathered to hear Barack Obama deliver key foreign policy speech on his current European tour. Democratic presidential hopeful laid out his vision for America's place in a new world order, saying he was speaking as a proud citizen of the world, of the world, of the world.
It is a big idea. It is a big idea. A new world order.
Hello, friends. I am the AntiTerrorist. Thank you for all of your emails and your messages of support and for staying part of the conversation.
If we are going to put an end to global poverty, now is the time to stock up on trainers. I'm joking. We're not going to put an end to global poverty.
You know, despite my anarchist leanings, if the recent London riots have shown us anything at all, it's that there's a need for nannies, for those who aren't grown up enough to embrace adulthood. And I'm sure the likes of Gordon Hall and Brandon Adams would agree, the guardian ward system we have in place works very well, despite its nefarious aspects. And your guardian needs to know if you're trustworthy enough, whether or not you're grown up enough to be left alone in the house without a babysitter. Because if they leave you alone and you stick your tongue in a light socket, not only are you likely to electrocute yourself, but you're probably going to start a fire that will take out your neighbours as well. And once you can prove you can be a responsible, self-governing, self-sufficient, self-educated, respectful and respectable grown-up, then and only then should you be left alone once you've properly removed yourself from the system, or learned to operate powerfully within it. And I've come to the conclusion that this education is not for everyone, which is why I stopped broadcasting on the subject some time ago. Some of the comments on my court and police videos made me realize I may have done the equivalent of giving a bullied adolescent a loaded shotgun. I also realized that access to this knowledge is something of a rite of passage and requires a profound level of responsibility. People should be left alone to find this information when they're ready to understand what's required of them, instead of having it spoon-fed to them by so-called gurus selling guesswork and unverified administrative procedures, which can only be dangerous to those who tend to go off half-cocked, in my opinion. Anyone selling this sort of half-baked nonsense to immature minds needs to search his or her conscience. Now, there are those who've been in this game for longer than you have, who've given their tried and tested knowledge freely and with integrity. And Mary Croft comes to mind. Her profound ebook, How I Clobbered Every Bureaucratic Cash Confiscatory Agency Known to Man, has been the catalyst for many. Yet, to the best of my knowledge, she gave it away free then, and it's still freely available now. Now, pioneers like Mary, Robert Menard, Arthur Christian, Brandon Adams, and Gordon Hall, who've been proactive, making mistakes, learning from them, and then passing their results on for our benefit. People like that should be supported and appreciated because they've been walking this path for long enough to know what works and what doesn't. Any new faces popping up claiming to have the answers deserve your intense scrutiny before you hand over your hard-earned monopoly money. Now, you're not going to get a how-to from me. As I've always said, I'm happy to point you in the right direction, but I won't be your personal trainer. So speaking of monopoly money, let's go over the foundational basics once more for the noobs. So using the game of Monopoly as a reference, when we register to play the game, we were allocated a person. You, the player, are not of the game, you're in it. You have an avatar that represents you. I mean, after all, you can't stand on the board and move around it as the dice demands. Your feet are too big. And if you want to do that, you should be playing Twister. And whether it's a Scotty dog, a racing car, a hat, a shoe, or whatever's left after your immature friends have grabbed all the cool-looking ones. So the Scotty dog is your person, it's your front man, the corporation you're using to make a profit, to buy property and so on. And once you've been allocated an avatar, a trust is created in that instant, and the trustee, the administrator of the trust, is responsible for all charges relating to that account, to that Scotty dog, to that person, that corporation. But thanks to our ignorance of the rules, we are immediately presumed to be the trustee. We are actually the grantors, because our participation in the game empowers the banker to create £200 and hand it to us for use in the game. But we're also the beneficiaries, the £200 starting cash being one of the benefits. Now, it is in fact the banker who's the trustee and responsible for the charges.
For and on the record, sir, do you understand that I'm only the beneficiary, not the trustee? Well, then why are you asking me questions? There's the agent for the trustee over there, the prosecutor. So have him handle it. I claim against the trustee and its agents to settle all charges for the benefit of the beneficiaries, public and private.
The banker, the government, regulates the flow of currency in the game and operates as the go-between when making commercial transactions. Now, if there's a tax of some sort to be paid, whether it's because you've landed on another's property or you've houses or hotels on your own property, or you get a crappy chance card, keep this distinction in mind. It's the avatar, the Scotty dog, the trust that's being taxed, not you, the player. And if you want to get a better understanding of the way the trust works, I recommend watching Dean Clifford's series on the subject. And there are links below. So Monopoly is a classic example of commerce in action. And it's helpful to learn the Monopoly rules in order to thrive in the game. We're dealing with avatars and Monopoly money in life, too. You have to know how to present and establish the facts. These corporations and the governments and courts they control don't care about your truth. There's no truth in the game of Monopoly, just rules and facts. Now, hopefully by now you should be clear that the government can't deal with you directly. That would be like the banker peeling his face off the Monopoly board and looking at you, the player, straight in the eye. They need you to volunteer to be the Scotty dog, the name, the trustee, to make money. The government's right there. They want to litigate. They want to take you to court. They're chomping at the bit because every time they do, they make money. And we don't want to go to court. We're timid, terrified, and fearful of going to court because every time we go in there, we lose money. And that's the way the system's designed. The government comes to you and says,
"Hey, let's flip a coin. If it comes up heads, we win. If it comes up tails, you lose. But just to show you how fair we want to be, we're going to let you flip the coin, fella. How you like them apples?"
As I've previously asserted, the key aspect here is contract. You contracted for the status of Scotty Dog, citizen, driver, person, ward of the state, in order to receive the benefits. You contracted to be on the Monopoly board. And all the while you're volunteering to be in the game, you're always going to be associated with your avatar. Expecting the banker to ignore the Scotty dog, the avatar, and deal with you, the player, directly, and to afford you all of the rights of the player within the fictional game is just pure nonsense. You gave up your unalienable rights for civil rights, privileges granted by the state. Now, there are still unalienable rights available to you, but only if you waive the civil rights. It's presumed and assumed that until you do waive those civil rights, by rescission, that you still want them. And by legal logic, they supersede your natural rights until you do. And if you have any of the contracts in place that bind you to the state, like a passport, any licenses or permits, an EIN or SIN number, or a national insurance number, and so on, you're simply not out of the system, and therefore not truly free. Even if you don't carry a UK passport with you when traveling, but still have one registered in your name, if you haven't rescinded it properly and ended the contract, you are not a free man on the land. Any contract you have with the government ties you to specific performance, and you've lost your property right as it relates to that endeavor. Got a marriage license? You lost your rights concerning your family.
"You can't do this to me. I'm free. I'm a free man on the land. I'm free. I'll sue the shit out of you, you mother fudgers. You son of a biscuit. No, I'm free. Leave me alone.
Got a driver's license. You lost all your rights concerning travel and so on down the line. And I'm seeing more and more cases where people will get into a registered vehicle while still bound by a driver's contract, as evidenced by the fact they still have a driver's license, and when stopped claim they're free men and that they're actually traveling. They're clearly not traveling. They're driving because they've waived their right to travel until they rescind their license and use an unregistered car. You don't have a leg to stand on. Give it up. Now, whatever you're doing inside the clubhouse you joined, the United Kingdom Corporation or the United States Corporation, a club that's extended its boundaries by franchise and business development to the four corners of the land, you're bound by the rules of that club. I mean, as an example, you can't bring your own popcorn into the Odeon cinema. They have rules within their own establishment. But you can eat as much of your own popcorn as you like in the car park. I really can't make it much simpler than that. Oh, and let's clear up another doozy.
Tonight, a story about a group of Americans you've likely never heard of. They're called sovereign citizens. Many don't pay taxes, carry a driver's license, or hold a Social Security card. They have little regard for the police or the courts. Some have become violent. The FBI lists them among the nation's top domestic terror threats. By some estimates, there are as many as 300,000 sovereign citizens in the U.S. And with the sluggish economy and mortgage mess, their ranks are growing.
Well, regardless of where you were born, each of us is a citizen of some country. Each of us have to abide by the laws of that country. But here in the U.S., an increasing number of people are declaring themselves sovereign citizens. They want nothing to do with the U.S. government, they don't want to pay taxes, and they claim that U.S. laws do not apply to them.
They are seemingly ordinary people, just like you and me, but they don't recognize the federal government's authority to impose laws or taxes on them. They're known as sovereign citizens.
Some were part of what is called the sovereign citizen movement. They believe the government has no right to tax or impose laws on them. In 2010 alone, sovereign citizens have filed liens, cease and desist orders, and documents called letters of marque or truth affidavits against officers and agencies across the country.
In fact, we're talking about the sovereign citizen movement in the U.S. According to a new report by the Southern Poverty Law Center, this is a movement that really is gaining a lot of traction. We've discussed it before, but now they say that there are over 300,000 Americans that consider themselves to be sovereign citizens.
The use of the term sovereign citizen in the mainstream media is done on purpose to confuse those who don't know any better. It's an oxymoron. You're either a sovereign or a citizen. You can't be both. It's literally like saying, I'm a player avatar. You're claiming your rights and then giving them away in the same breath.
One of the most extreme things people can do to protect their privacy is to expatriate from the United States. Whether it's because you don't like having to check in for every little thing that you do with the government, or if you're already an international person and you don't like having to pay taxes when a lot of the money you make and a lot of the money you spend doesn't ever touch the U.S. There could be a million reasons why you want to expatriate, and a lot more people are doing it now.
I have written a little about expatriation, and that's one of the answers. However, becoming stateless has many dangers and pitfalls. You'd have no protection from pirates in other states. And you've probably never heard of a chap called Jeff Nabel. News about him has been purposefully ignored across the mainstream media. And Jeff Nabel saw beyond the pomp, the pageantry and lies of the flag and patriotism, and in 1995 he attempted to extract himself from the system. Nabel burned his American passport and renounced his American citizenship in 2009, making himself stateless. He wanted to move about freely without hiding or risking harassment by government authorities. Besides, he wished to demonstrate that governments were truly coercive because they didn't allow one to withdraw from citizenship, from paying taxes, and from using government identification documents. He moved to India and was harassed by the Indian government until, as a final protest, he burned himself to death in January of this year. And you probably never heard anything about that, did you? Governments, especially the US government, are quick to block any mention of these type of acts. They know that people in the US are reaching their limit with the government, and that it could just be one simple act, like that of Nabel, that could trigger an uprising. You know, this is the reason the U.S. government wants an internet kill switch. It's not to prevent internet terrorist attacks, something that's never happened and is basically impossible. It's to prevent the people of the U.S. from organizing an uprising against the government. The U.S. government has a long list of abuses over the last century. So from their perspective, resistance to government must be censored or squashed as quickly as possible, lest the slaves get out of order. So there's a heavy focus at the moment on ways to free ourselves from our own governments. As I've suggested, Nonviolent resistance can be accomplished through expatriation of self and wealth, through throwing off government fiat currencies in favor of hard money, like gold and silver, and finding places on earth that are least oppressive to your rights and your capital, which is why forming free man communities is essential for community immunity. Arthur and Fiona Christian in Australia and Robert Menard are doing something similar with the likes of the Freeman Society and whatnot. Essentially, they're forming another, better club to join. And one thing I recommend you do is visit thedollarvigilante.com. Shortly, they'll be offering a service to their subscribers of a second passport from a country that's freer than the US and the UK, and who only taxes its citizens on an income earned inside the country. All other worldwide income's not taxed. So have a look at that, thedollarvigilante.com. Besides the fact they're making this offer to their subscribers, I find their daily newsletter to be absolutely essential reading. Now, if you're a little confused having seen this broadcast, if you're unsure about what you need to do next, if you're angry or you feel cheated because I've not revealed some secret or other, then maybe you need to accept the possibility that you're not ready. You haven't understood the basic premise that besides all of the corruption, the nefarious government activities, the voluntary servitude, there's a guardian ward system that works well to keep the willfully ignorant, the unlawful, the lazy or unable fenced in and taken care of. It's a deeply flawed system, no question. But it's all we've got for now. Now, your way out is self-education and proving that you understand the system, that you have the integrity required for them to leave you to your own devices. If you want to leave, your job is to do it diligently and quietly, not belligerently. If you really want out, if you're serious about giving up the benefits, if you know you're ready, really ready, then you'll find the key easily enough, and the door will appear in front of you. It's always been there. And if you leave without yelling and screaming foul play, or trying to tell all of the unprepared folk where the door is, you probably won't even have to go through the court to get out. If you refuse to take responsibility for your own freedom at every step of your life, and expect someone else to do your homework or the hard work needed to restore your sovereignty, your freedom's going to last for about 5 minutes. And expecting to simply pay money for someone else to carry out the sovereignty process for you, or that there'll be a magic bullet that will keep you from pain or effort, or prevent the need for commitment on your part, well, that just isn't sensible, responsible, or adult. And no amount of money paid to others will solve the main problem, which is your own ignorance of the law, apathy, and irresponsibility. And someone very clever once said, the truth is best obtained from those who aren't trying to sell you anything. And Benjamin Franklin, one of America's founding fathers, as he left the Constitutional Convention, when questioned about what kind of government they created, was quoted as saying, a republic, ma'am, if you can keep it. Now, the measure of whether you can keep it, meaning the republic, indicated by Franklin, is the degree to which you take complete and exclusive responsibility for yourself. And the minute you ignore this calling is the minute you not only become slave to your own ignorance, but to unscrupulous sellers of freedom will try to profit from your laziness by offering you franchises designed to fleece you of your hard-earned monopoly money. And now, as a final thought regarding the Middle East debacle, I think it's clear to even the doziest of sleepers that there's something a little odd going on here. You know, the old adage that says history repeats itself is exactly true. Mankind has gone through war after war after war. And all the time they're going to war, they're talking about peace. In fact, someone quite prophety had something to say about that. He said that when they cry peace, peace, and there is no peace, you'll know that war is right around the corner.
What happened at 9/11 is we didn't have a strategy, we didn't have bipartisan agreement, we didn't have American understanding of it, and we had instead a policy coup in this country. A coup. A policy coup. Some hard-nosed people took over the direction of American policy, and they never bothered to inform the rest of us. I went through the Pentagon 10 days after 9/11. I couldn't stay away from Mother Army. I went back there to see Don Rumsfeld. I'd worked for him as a White House fellow in the 1970s. All this is in the book. And I said, am I doing okay on CNN? He said, yeah, fine. He said, I'm thinking about it. He says, I read your book. And he said, this is a book that talks about the Kosovo campaign. And he said, I just want to tell you, he said, nobody's going to tell us where or when we can bomb. Nobody. He said, I'm thinking of calling this a floating coalition. What do you think about that? I said, well, sir, thanks for reading my book. And, he said, thanks. That's all the time I've got. Really? And I went downstairs. I was leaving the Pentagon, and an officer from the Joint Staff called me into his office and said, I want you to know, he said, sir, we're going to attack Iraq. And I said, why? He said, we don't know. He said, I said, well, did they tie Saddam to 9/11? He said, no. He said, but I guess it's they don't know what to do about terrorism. And so they think, but they can attack states, and they want to look strong. And so I guess they think if they take down a state, it will intimidate the terrorists. And, you know, it's like that old saying, he said, if the only tool you have is a hammer, then every problem has to be a nail. Well, I walked out of there pretty upset. And then we attacked Afghanistan. I was pretty happy about that. We should have. And then I came back to the Pentagon about 6 weeks later. I saw the same officer. I said, why haven't we attacked Iraq? We still going to attack Iraq? He said, oh, sir. He says, it's worse than that. He said, he pulled up a piece of paper off his desk. He said, I just got this memo from the Secretary of Defense's office. It says we're going to attack and destroy the governments in seven countries in 5 years. We're going to start with Iraq, and then we're going to move to Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. I said, seven countries in 5 years. I said, is that a classified memo? He said, yes, sir.
As I've said previously, you can't have a one-world government, a one-world currency, or a one-world religion if there are parts of the world who won't play. And besides that aspect, there is another more obvious one. I'll let Brian Cox fill you in.
The organizing principle of any society is for war. The basic authority of a modern state over its people resides in its war powers. Today, it's oil. Tomorrow, water. It's what we like to call the God business. Guns, oil, and drugs. But there's a problem.
I don't give a shit.
My way of life. It's over. It's unsustainable and in rapid decline. That's why we implement demand destruction. We continue to make money as the world burns. But for this to work, the people have to remain ignorant of the problem until it's too late. That's why we have triggers in place. 9/11, 7/7, WMDs. A population in a permanent state of fear does not ask questions. Our desire for war becomes its desire. A willing sacrifice. You see? Fear is justification. Fear is control. Fear is money.
A peaceful republic, fella. If you can keep it. Thanks for listening.
And people better understand that they mean exactly what they're saying. It's a new world order they're trying to create, and they're trying to do so not only without approval or consent of the government in this country, but despite the popular will. This is a straightforward assault by the elitists in this country.